Matt Polka here in D.C., today right out in front of Union Station, but back in D.C. to bring you another of our DC2U video and podcast series. That's where we bring DC2U, our listeners, bringing you the advocates, the regulators, the lawmakers, and those who make a difference in Washington, D.C. Today we're talking about an issue that is near and dear to our members' heart, and that's retransmission consent. And we're talking with people today from the American Television Alliance about not only retransmission consent reform, but the work of the American Television Alliance, ATVA, on how it works with ACA Connects to try to win retransmission consent reform in Washington, D.C. Today we'll have Mike Chappell, who's the executive director of ATVA, Trent Duffy, who's a spokesman for ATVA and also a principal in HDMK, and also John Simpson, who's here today on behalf of Ride TV, one of the independent programmers that supports our efforts on retrans reform. So let's get right to it with our DC2U podcast with the American Television Alliance. Hi everybody, Matt Polka here again with ACA Connects with another DC2U video and audio podcast where we bring DC2U with people here in DC that are involved in key issues that our members care about and that consumers care about. And today we're here talking with folks from the American Television Alliance, also known as ATVA, about an issue that's near and dear to our members' heart, and that is retransmission consent, the possibility for reform of retransmission consent in 2019, and the broader harms caused by old and outdated rules to consumers and competition. I'm here today with Mike Chappell, who is Executive Director of the American Television Alliance. Mike, glad to have you with us.
Thanks, Matt.
Trent Duffy, spokesman for ATVA. And also John Simpson, who is a representative of Ride TV, one of our independent programming members.
Great to be here. Thanks, Matt.
Great to have you guys. Why don't you first tell us a little bit about yourself?
Matt, I am a native Mississippian who moved to D.C. about 20 years ago, spent about 10 years.
Started lobbying you about then, too, as I remember.
I spent about 10 years on the Hill, was where we first met, and I've been off the Hill for about as long now. And as you were discussing a while ago, I'm sorry, I'm a Caps fan.
That's okay.
As we're raising the children that way.
Yes, indeed. Penguins versus Caps. We'll see you in the second round. Trent, how about you?
I moved to Washington in 1989, working for a former member of Congress, Mike Oxley. Worked for several members on the Hill, also worked at the Ways and Means Committee, and then eventually found myself working for President George W. Bush in the White House as his deputy press secretary. I left that point of my service and started our own communications firm, and we're happy to work with ATVA as one of our best projects. We've been working with them for several years, so we've seen the blackout crisis get worse in the time that we've been engaged, which I think we're going to get to in a minute.
I didn't know about your background. We just had Ari Fleischer as a keynote speaker at our recent independent show. It was awesome.
Ari's a very good friend and mentor of mine over the years, both at Ways and Means and then later at the White House. Yes.
I'll bet. John, tell us about yourself.
So I spent about 6 years on Capitol Hill, in D.C. generally, four of which are worked on the Hill. Spent the rest of my time at a law firm working on telecommunications issues. I've been working on retransmission consent for almost 10 years, and I represent a handful of independent programmers that are all very concerned about the rising cost of retransmission consent and how that impacts their ability to get carriage and be able to be paid for their content when they're only asking for a couple of pennies and our broadcaster friends are asking for a bunch of dollars.
That's for sure. It's great to have Ride TV as a member of ATVA along with ACA Connects and so many others. So let's start there, Mike. The American Television Alliance. Tell us a little bit about it, what it is, what you do, what you try to accomplish.
Sure. So the ATVA is actually a pretty unique thing, I think, for Washington in that we've got a really diverse group of actors who, whether it's in the marketplace, in the commercial sector, are fighting each other for businesses, for customers in the businesses, or sometimes on many policy issues, have disagreement on the Hill, very strenuously fighting each other, but have all come together and formed the American Television Alliance to work together to really try to seek to educate, to advocate, and ultimately get reforms to the retransmission consent regime. We engage not only on the Capitol Hill, but at the FCC as well in proceedings and actions that happen over there. We've got a great press team who engage not only with the trade press and the national press here, but with local press back in real America to kind of educate and inform again about what retransmission consent is and how it affects people in their everyday lives, because most people, like a lot of the big words we throw around in Washington are acronyms. What is retransmission consent regime, and how does it actually affect an individual person, but just everybody that has pay TV? It affects not only your life and what you watch on the dial, but your wallet as well. So kind of that education component of the public and the policymakers here is the driving kind of day in and day out. We spend most of our time doing, and again, that education is all ultimately to try to get the goal to change the rules that created the retransmission consent regime, which, as you well know, were created in 1992.
We're going to get to the definitional question in a second. But I do want to ask you a follow-up to ATVA. You know, in Washington, it's hard to get things done. It's difficult. You don't see it very often, but sometimes effective advocates do so as part of a coalition, which is really what we've done at the American Television Alliance. Tell us about just the nature of coalition building in Washington, how that makes a difference, and how when you're bringing in, you know, new parties to your cause, you start a cause, but then you bring others, how that can have maybe even broader impact in your advocacy.
Right. Well, look, I mean, ATVA was started about 10 years ago, and when it was first started, it was a kind of a compact group of people that were really spending the time and engagement with us at the FCC or in the press and on the Hill. And over the time, you know, more people have joined. And again, kind of the disparate parties, whether it's some of the biggest companies in America to some of the smallest companies in America, to on the pay TV side, and then independent programmers like Riot TV and others that have a different view. We've got consumer groups that are part of the coalition.
Right.
We've got partners that are not officially ATVA members but work hand in glove with us. Again, whether it's on the Hill or in the press or at the FCC, groups kind of on the kind of the center left ideological view of the world, or the center right. I mean, we've got literally every kind of component and faction of what happens in the policy realm in Washington. There is a factor of that that is supportive of us of getting reform, because it's such a transparent view when you look at the policy, that whether you come from the left or the right or a free market system or a heavy hand of government regulatory system, that the market is not working now. And so when you've got representatives from all of those kind of different pieces, the policymakers, whether it's the Hill or the media that's watching it or the regulators, it gives you street cred, if you will,
right,
of this is not just one entity that's coming to seeking a special interest fix from Washington, which we all hear so much about. This gives you the kind of the credibility that this is a real issue that has real effects on real people.
Well,
and
you
not
have
just
done
one
a
person.
Terrific job leading our work here at the American Television Alliance, that we at ACA Connects are proud to be a member. I'm going to get to that definitional question. Of course, as John was indicating, we live this retransmission consent issue. I've been in Washington more than 25 years, and not one day have I been here without retransmission consent as an issue in my work. But let's be broader here, because we hope that people will listen to our podcast to actually become more informed about this issue. So let's start with the basics. Mike, what is retransmission consent?
Sure. So in its simplest form, it is the structure in which a negotiation happens between a pay TV provider, again, whether that's your local cable company, your satellite company, or if your phone company. It's the negotiation that happens between that pay TV provider and the local broadcaster, your local ABC, CBS, et cetera, affiliate, and how that negotiation happens and takes place. And the retransmission consent regime, as I said a minute ago, was created in 1992 when Congress wrote the 1992 Cable Act. And obviously, you know, one of the things that's most transparent to people understand is that in 1992, the world was vastly different than it is today.
Yeah.
Not only from the stands of the marketplace in 1992, DirecTV didn't exist, Dish didn't exist, Verizon didn't have their Fios capability. None of that existed, let alone Netflix and all of our phones,
exactly,
and Amazon Prime and the rest of it. But at its core, it's that negotiation that takes place, and it's a government-created structure on how that negotiation happens. And we could talk for 30 more minutes alone just on all of the obligations that pay TV providers and the benefits that the broadcasters have as a part of the 1992 Act that just don't make sense
anymore.
And
other related regulations that create,
absolutely,
you know, more of that kind of system that really is take it or leave it.
It's created this you know, matrix of rules and regs that govern how this negotiation should take place. And those rules, again, were created for a time where you had one cable company as your only pay TV provider option. And now you've got this entire wealth of competition out there. That's a good thing for consumers, but again, it's changed so much, the rules don't make sense anymore, and that's why we have the prices that we're seeing.
Right.
And I think the important thing to discuss here is that retransmission consent is really a government attempt to create a market. And that's the fundamental problem.
From 1992.
From 1992. Right. And that's the fundamental problem with retransmission consent. If you go back a little bit in history and you think about how we got here today, broadcasting originally, you had a big station in New York and it broadcast its signal out as far as it could possibly reach. And that was great. Broadcasters, people got free over-the-air television. Eventually, people on the other side of the Appalachian Mountains wanted to be able to watch TV, or they lived in a valley and they couldn't do it. And so some entrepreneur put up a big antenna, started collecting that
signal.
One
of our members, actually. That's right.
Wanted to collect that signal and distribute it to the people that couldn't view it on their own. And that worked very well. So Congress created a compulsory copyright license so that all of that could be facilitated. And in the cable business, sort of sprouted out. At that time, broadcasters eventually came around and said, geez, there's all these cable channels out there, and they got this great dual revenue stream. We certainly would like to have a great dual revenue stream, but we sure don't want to get rid of that compulsory copyright license. Mm-hmm. And so let's create an artificial market. You create a bunch of bureaucracy and a bunch of rules, and that will allow us to get that dual revenue stream. And that's how we ended up with
retransmission consent. Well said, John. We're policy guys. We work here in D.C. We try to win change. But Trent, there's a bigger issue here at stake, and that's how these old, outdated rules literally affect consumers. Consumers may not really know about this. I mean, they see it when they see blackouts on television. But the bottom line question that I think is really important is, why should consumers care?
Well, two reasons. It's for what they're paying for, because they are, like you said, experiencing blackouts. They're being victimized by these old, outdated rules. The rationale for the 1992 Cable Act and this ridiculous, warped market has expired. And so the first way they get victimized is through a blackout. And more we're seeing that what is getting blacked out is the programming that they love the most. It's live television sports. It's the Oscars. It's college football. It's the playoffs. If you think about any marquee programming, which is must-see TV, it has been used as leverage in a retransmission consent negotiation. The broadcaster threatens to pull the signal, and it leaves the pay TV provider in the worst possible position, because they want to provide that programming to their viewers. But the second really big issue is the money that the viewers are paying.
Sure.
It was said earlier that this is free over-the-air TV. If you had a decent antenna, you could get it for free. And that was also an original part of the deal the government made with broadcasters. But now, under these sorts of arrangements, consumers and viewers are paying billions and billions of dollars, and it keeps skyrocketing. The latest estimate is that American consumers could spend upwards of $12 billion in 2019 for retransmission consent fees. That is a huge hit on the economy, and it's unnecessary, and it's going 2, 3x, 4x. It's going at an uncontrollable pace, and that's why I think we're seeing the combination of blackouts and soaring retransmission fees driving the conversation in Congress.
And I think it's also one of the reasons why we're seeing more bipartisan concern.
I think that's right.
Over higher cost to consumers as well as blackouts because of the impact of these outdated regulations. So that's really good.
I think you have to also just look to the success of ATVA here. There is one coalition that is growing in Washington, D.C., and it is the folks that are opposed to retransmission consent. There's another a group that has stayed the same. They have the same number of advocates, and it's the National Association of Broadcasters. The fact that there are more organizations and folks like Riot TV that are coming to the table and saying, geez, this is really starting to affect us, folks on the right and folks on the left.
Well, that's what I wanted to ask you, John. Why does Riot TV care? Why are you a member of ATVA?
So this is a very important issue for independent programmers. And really for what Trent just mentioned is, when you see retransmission consent costs going up from a couple of $100 million just 10 years ago to almost $12 billion today, that money's got to come from somewhere. The other thing that we are seeing is that there is sort of an elasticity of demand in cable prices as you get more and more competitors. What does that mean for the non-economist? It's pretty simple. It means that those retransmission consent costs can't be passed along to the consumer, and so they got to come from somewhere. And those cuts are coming from independent programmers, and in a lot of cases, coming from rural broadband deployment. And when you are an independent programmer like Rye TV that primarily focuses on rural consumers, those really cut deep, and that's a huge, huge concern for us.
So the impact of rising retransmission consent fees is that cable operators have to pay more for that quote-unquote free over-the-air programming, which means less money for more diverse programming sources.
Exactly. We estimate that a 20% increase in retransmission consent costs equates to approximately 35 to 45 cents on the cable bill. 35 to 45 cents could support about 6 independent networks. So, you know, we get very little payment for our content. Some of us don't get paid at all. But that 35 to 45 cents is 6 channels that you would lose simply to keep your broadcast television.
Trent, go ahead.
Yeah, no, and that raises another, like, third aspect that I think has gotten worse, and maybe Mike can add some color here, is that it's not only the free over-the-air NBC sort of mainstream broadcast channels that are part of this discussion, and which is adding to the increased viewer bill. It's the channels that a lot of people don't want, and they don't want to pay for. So part of this negotiation is, yes, you can get my college football game, but you have to take the tennis channel, and your people have to pay for the tennis channel, or they have to pay for ESPNU and ESPN2 and ESPN this and ESPN that. And I mean, we're all sports fans here, and it's a big part of, you know, what we're
sure.
But a lot of people don't like ESPN.
A lot of people don't.
A lot of people don't want it. A lot of senior citizens, women, they don't care. You know, they just don't want that. But they're being forced to pay for that to get Dancing with the Stars or to get something else that they really do want. So that's why it's not just a matter of paying for, you know, these channels that, you know, are more mainstream. It's all the other stuff. And so it's really... it's interesting because it's really the broadcasters that are responsible for the cable bundle, as we've all known to kind of know it, and not providers.
Just a quick story, Trent. I've literally had a conversation over my hedge with my next door, dear next door neighbor, who's in her 70s, lovely lady, who said to me, why do I have to pay for all of these sports channels I don't want? Exactly. So, I mean, it's a real life thing. Mike?
It is. No, I mean, it is. And look, we hear this constantly from you know, members like yours and others of that as part of the deal. It's not just the money that you're paying increasingly more and more every year, but it's the packages from some of the broadcast groups or some of the networks themselves. And you know, again, when they've got the leverage of there's one place to go in a market to get that network content to make sure you're gonna have the Super Bowl or the World Series or the Stanley Cup, you know, they've got the leverage to get it, and you're gonna pay what they're gonna ask, or you go dark. And you lose customers, and part of that is increasingly, as he was saying, is it's more of this other content that, you know, the consumers don't want. And again, we talked about the stuff that's happening on the iPads and the phones. Consumers want video that they want, when they want it, where they want it. And it's not the rules and the system that's created in 1992. They want to take it on their kids. I mean, my kids don't watch TV. It's all on that thing, right? It's all the OTTs or the apps, you know, from the cable system at home. It's people want change and how this all works today, and retrans is certainly a big piece of this, but frankly, Congress should be looking at the whole system, because consumers do want things differently. They want it where they want it, when they want it, how they want it, and they're not getting that. Your companies are not able to do everything that they may like to do because of the regulatory morass that they have to operate in. You operate and are regulated as a cable company. There are things that a satellite company can do that you can't do, and vice versa, and the same for a phone company. And the OTT guys can basically do whatever they want to under contract law. And maybe that's the way we should go, maybe it's not. But Congress should have a discussion about where it is that consumers want to go. Where is technology taking us? What's the next round of competition that's going to evolve? I mean, you know, one of the things that was embodied in the spirit of the 92 Act was to try to give some competition to cable. Mm-hmm. Well, that worked, you know. We've got satellite companies, we've got the phone companies. That's been a great thing, but the perverse part of it now is it's created this morass with retrans, where we've gone from $1 billion to $12 billion of fees in eight years.
Yeah.
And that's because the system is not working anymore. The goal was accomplished, it's time to refresh. rules are, you know, it's like a loaf of bread. So a loaf of bread's not good forever.
Right. No, it spoils, as rules do. So let me ask you this. Way back in 1993, I was a small cable lawyer, the general counsel for a small cable company. And I negotiated some of the earliest retrans agreements where our small cable company negotiated with small broadcasters in our markets. And it was a small cable company and a small broadcaster negotiation. But today we're talking about billions of dollars in retransmission consent and trying to demonstrate the relevance of this not only to consumers to care about it, but also to Congress. What's happened in that time by way of market forces that have caused this enormous change and problem with retransmission consent?
Two big things. The ad revenues to the broadcasters have dropped precipitously because of all the competition that Mike has mentioned and that we're all discussing. And then the second is they've got to please their shareholders. So the broadcasters are brazenly, they brag about this on their earnings calls. They have to replace that ad revenue from somewhere. And they're increasingly looking to retrans for that, for those funds. CBS had in their business plan that they wanted to grow retrans revenue by a huge amount, and you can see that they just had a huge blackout with AT&T as a result of doing that. So it's being embodied. So, and I think their actions belie and underscore the fact that maybe they are seeing the writing on the wall that this cannot stand anymore. That they are really, this is a real money grab right now before Congress steps in, because it can only go on so long. So I think those are the two things that at least I see as a layperson, but you guys are the experts.
Consolidation is certainly one on the broadcast side, on the kind of the broadcast ownership group side, but the secondarily back for the networks. And like, you know, again in 92, retrans is for your small company,
right?
That revenue that your company was going to pay that broadcaster was for that local broadcast station. Now, huge chunks of that money that, again, go back and read the intent of the chairman of the House and Senate Commerce Committees at the time, that retrans money was for to ensure there was local news, sports weather, local content. Now huge chunks of that money are flowing back to New York and LA to the networks themselves, because they are demanding, on top of the franchise fees that those affiliates are paying, they now are demanding a part of that retrans agreement fee. So there are some local mom and pops. They're in a bind too. They've got a negotiate and they've got to send some back. So I think that's another piece. I think that it's called reverse compensation of sending it back up to the networks in New York and LA, as well as the consolidation
raises the retail price, because again, consumers, there's a payment that's already paid by the broadcast, the local affiliate, to the network before the broadcaster even comes to the cable or satellite provider to ask for payment. There's already a heightened
price.
So
now they've got a dual revenue stream for themselves back at the networks.
And it's a payment that really has no public interest benefits. You know, one of the broadcasters, the argument they always make is retransmission consent, as Mike said, it goes to pay for local news, weather. When a significant portion of that is being siphoned off and sent back to the networks, that's not being spent to improve your local weather radar or to buy a new helicopter for traffic. Those revenues are not staying in the local market. They're going to New York and they're going to LA.
And we have weather apps and Waze and all these other ways to get information at a real-time basis that didn't exist before. And that's another aspect of the competition.
It is almost incredible that we're talking about these facts as well as these numbers in terms of increases at a time when you look certainly within the cable or satellite industry that is dealing with the massive effects of cord cutting. I literally had one member of ours tell a broadcast group that was considering essentially how retransmission consent could be the savior of their future from a broadcast perspective. He said, I don't know that I would go too far in betting that, because out of every 10 new customers that sign up for my service, only 2 are taking cable. And in my existing subscriber base, people that already had video, phone, broadband, I'm seeing like 40% decreases in cable subscriptions. So what are we monetizing? Yep. Because the numbers of subscribers that basically are retransmission consent payment centers every month are decreasing, but we're still seeing the numbers edge upward. I mean, this is a case where I think Washington finally does have to recognize the nature of these old and outdated rules, and they need to be changed.
The system's not sustainable for anybody, you know, not even for the broadcast. I mean, I think Trent's right. At some point, you know, they've got the golden goose and the golden egg right now and the golden nest, and that's great for them, but they're helping to cannibalize the business that pay TV is now with forcing the, you know, the 300 channels and the, you know, the over the $100 cable bill. You know, consumers, again, want smaller packages, the skinny bundles. They, you know, they want more choices, and, you know, pay TV providers are forced to do the opposite.
Yeah.
And it's cannibalizing and making the system worse that they're accelerating, I believe, that cord cutting and moving to the OTT platforms. And OTT is not going to provide you the local news, sports, and weather unless you're looking at, you know, somebody who's doing a podcast from somewhere locally.
Right.
They're destroying their own thing. And, you know, it would be nice if they actually would come to the table with us and actually work with Congress to see how we can all, you know, work together for what, you know, what is in everybody's interest moving forward. You're a witness from Missouri that was so
Patty Boyers, our new chair,
eloquent at the House Commerce Committee, talked about how she, you know, she did want her local broadcaster there, that they were partners in business, and she needed them and they needed her, and that's all true. But this system is not going to sustain. I mean, you know, we don't want to see your companies and AT&T and Charters and others become just a broadband platform. That's not good for the communities. It's not good for the broadcasters or Ride TV or anybody else. So it's a changing dynamic, and the broadcasters can kind of try to milk this cow until the last drop comes out, but it's not sustainable. It's not in their own interest.
Right. So let's talk about now efforts for reform. There's this thing this year called, we know it as Stellar, S-T-E-L-A-R. Check me if I get this right. The Satellite Television Extension Localism Act Reauthorization.
Good job.
Big acronym.
That was before they started putting bumper sticker names on bills in Congress.
Exactly.
People like me were working.
Yeah. I'd like the N retrans bill. Okay. Right. That would be okay by me. But let's stick with Stellar for now. Mike, tell us what Stellar is, why it's an issue this year, and why, you know, this is a central piece of ATVA's advocacy.
Sure. So Stellar expires at the end of this year. So there's some pieces of legislation.
End of 2019.
End of December 31st, 2019, easy for me to say. As you know, some laws are permanent, last forever. Others have expiration dates. Stellar expires at the end of this year.
And this is a five-year bill,
this
basically.
This is a five-year bill. It's historically, the first one was in 1988, and we've done one every 5 years since then. There are basically two main components of it. One deals specifically with the two satellite companies, DirecTV and Dish, and how they are able and allowed to provide station content over their satellites. It's a compulsory license, Section 119. It can get very weedy quick, but essentially it's congressional authorization to provide signals into markets. The other piece that is very important provides the Federal Communications Commission's their very limited authority to look at the retransmission consent regime, as we call it, the good faith rules.
Under the good faith rules, right.
That's where that
And I don't think a lot of people actually realize that the FCC's good faith rules come from a bill that has to be reauthorized every 5 years.
Right, I was talking with a staffer today, I'd love to know where that came from. I have no idea why it's that way and was never made permanent either as a prior Stella or in the first place. But it literally is the only jurisdiction the commission has to look at a $12 billion industry. And again, as you and your members know, it's a very limited authority.
Exactly.
We would love to see it strengthen, and that's what we're shooting for. But that jurisdiction expires at the end of the year if Congress does not reauthorize it. So there are two bad things if Congress doesn't reauthorize it. One is the commission will lose its ability to have any sort of a look into this $12 billion industry. The other is there are about 870,000 American households that will lose access to network programming that they are, if they're a customer of Dish or DirecTV, that's programming that they're allowed to get because of Stellar. And if it goes away, then neither Dish nor DirecTV can provide that access anymore, and so they will lose signals overnight.
So we're in the fight for reauthorization this year. Trent and John, tell me why good faith matters.
I think for the reasons Mike just mentioned, that the FCC right now is the only referee really that we have. It's a very limited authority, but if that goes away, it just makes the blackout problem get much, much worse and makes the retrans regime much
more.
It'd be no check at all, right. It would be a blank check for broadcasters, actually, if you think about it that way, because there would be no way for the FCC to get involved in a retrans negotiation. So the broadcasters are essentially saying, We want bad faith. You know, the rules are already warped in our favor. We want you to warp them even further and not renew this important piece of legislation. So it's critical that I think all of us that are involved in this and victimized by this, especially viewers, again, who are paying the freight, need to get involved.
So John, even though you're here today with Rye TV, you've been involved in these issues, and to take that another step, I mean, good faith really has a lot to do with big and small, and small being able to protect against the big, right?
Sure, absolutely. You know, I think it's really important to talk about the good faith rules so people understand what they are, because it sounds like these would be some big rules that really define how and when you can negotiate and what sort of terms you can negotiate with. But here's a couple of the good faith rules so your members understand what we're trying to protect. It is considered to be bad faith if you refuse to negotiate at all. It is considered to be bad faith if you refuse to designate a representative with the authority to make decisions. It is considered to be bad faith if you refuse to meet at reasonable times and locations, so you can't say, you know, Christmas at midnight.
Which has happened.
That's exactly right.
You know, it's a refusal to put forth more than a single unilateral proposal. It's considered to be bad faith if you coordinate your retransmission consent negotiations with another broadcaster in the market. And that is really the key. That is one of the rules that I think, at least in my opinion, the broadcasters really want to go away, because that gives them the ability to take multiple stations in a market, coordinate all of those retransmission consent negotiations, and really drive up the price.
Scary stuff.
scary stuff indeed. But still, by the same token, while you have that protection, the good faith protection, which allows MVPDs, multi-video programming distributors, whether cable or satellite, to at least have some protection to bring to the FCC, the truth of the matter is that we're looking at historic numbers of blackouts.
That's right. Even with the FCC at the table.
Even with those rules.
So this is a necessary step.
So imagine what it is without.
Yeah, right, exactly.
I mean, the good faith rules are really, you know, that last weed that we hold on to before, you know, before prices really fall off the cliff and, you know, and consumers are really put into a really bad spot with significant increases.
Where are we right now in terms of numbers of blackouts, Trent?
Well, this year is the record number. We had 230 as of last week, which is well above the peak of 213 set 2 years ago. And it has soared in recent years. I think we had 8 in 2010, and now we have 230. And these are getting bigger and more.
Well, I was going to say, how many bigger millions of people do you think are affected by it?
Tens of millions. And it's getting worse every year.
Who don't have access to what's called free over-the-air television.
They don't have, and that, furthermore, that they had already paid for.
That they paid for.
Matt, right. And still want to, you know.
Mm-hmm. And still want to.
And they still want to. And, you know, our coalition was designed to protect those viewers in these negotiations, because they don't have a seat at the table if we're not there and if the FCC isn't there. As I've said in several interviews, they're not on the table. They are on the table. They're dinner. And they're the ones that are getting gouged in all this. And that's why the reauthorization is so important. But I think we've alluded to this earlier, the problem is getting worse for all the factors that we've been describing. You have the dynamics of the marketplace, which is not a real market. It's totally skewed in favor of broadcasters. And you have the dynamics of shrinking audiences for broadcast television. And so they need to make the money from somewhere to please shareholders.
So, Mike, coming back to Stellar, a very important development this year. We have two very senior members of the House Commerce Committee, House Energy and Commerce Committee. One, a very conservative Republican from Louisiana, Steve Scalise, who's the number two guy in the House, and another Congresswoman, Anna Eshoo from Silicon Valley, a Democrat, a liberal, as diametrically opposed politically as you can find in the U.S. Congress today, coming together after individually fighting for retransform for more than a decade individually, coming together to introduce something called the Modern Television Act of 2019. I just want to make a point about Congresswoman Eshoo. She came to our summit in 2015 to speak about this issue, where we still use this quote, where she, to our audience who loved it, basically said, retransmission consent is a racket. Those were her words. So, Mike, tell me about their bill, the Modern Television Alliance, why Modern Television Act bill of 2019, and why we at ATVA support that and want to see that move as a vehicle for reauthorization.
Absolutely. So first and foremost, I can't comment on without, you know, applauding the two of them.
Absolutely.
And exactly for the reason that you said, that they're, you know, they're both wonderful human beings and great members of Congress, but have different views of the world on a lot of different policy, but they both recognize that there's a problem here, and they've come across the lines and hammered out a true, you know, a compromise on them, and that's so rare in this town here lately, and I hope that all of their colleagues across the various committees look at them as an example of what actually should and can be happening in Washington. So there's my soapbox political speech. Sorry, I can't help it. But so look, they did. The piece of the legislation that they came up with is a true kind of compromise between the kind of two respective views that they had individually, where it tries to kind of reboot the market and get a lot of the old government rules and regulations off the table, out of the mix anymore, create some protections for consumers in terms of really, I think would really drastically limit the amount of blackouts that would happen potentially, and create some enforcement side on the FCC that once we get to this more kind of a true free market deregulated system, if it's not working as the way that we envision it will, that the commission has got some additional tools in the toolbox to try to kind of calibrate and see, you know, what's wrong, what's not working, to try to get things back working, so the consumers are the ones that are not holding the bag on this ultimately. It's a more complicated version of that, but I think at the top level,
sure,
that's sort of kind of, it's a deregulatory kind of free market approach with kind of a backstop at the commission to ensure the market's going to work the way we intended.
What are some of the reforms that we at the American Television Alliance have been bringing to the Hill and suggesting that they consider as part of a broader bill?
Sure. So, look, I mean, we would love to see Congress deal in a huge, big, comprehensive way, whether it's a SLEAS-SU bill or something else. The clock is just not with us this year, and as we've talked about, Stellar expires at the end of this year, which is our opportunity to move. This has always been a bill where other telecom things have been added on.
Which I just don't believe we'll have the big comprehensive fix, but we'll continue to push and talk.
Give me the
about
comprehensive
that.
Fix more so, as we've talked about in the past, such as like a Communications
right.
Act rewrite or something
right.
like that. Right?
It's just we just don't have the time to do that this year. So whatever we can get will be in the stellar. We've talked a lot about the consolidation on the broadcast side.
Mm-hmm.
And I think as we looked at all the kind of the symptoms of what hurts the negotiations the most, it's when you've got that sort of power, whether it's having duopolies and
control of the market.
One market. I mean, if you just own one broadcast station in a market, you've got market power. If you own two stations, you've got more. If you've got three, you got a lot. If you've got four, you own the city. And then we actually have that around the country where there are broadcast groups that own all four stations. So we you know, the commission has there's always been a top four prohibition where no one could own more than one station in a local market. The commission loosened the rules up a little bit, and the broadcasters have driven a truck through it. That's something we'd like to see kind of tighten back up. There's good reasons for it. I think there are two arguments when it was originally put in place. One was a concern for market power. The other, which doesn't have anything to do with our group, but I think still merits policy discussion, is ensuring there's divergent voices.
Mm-hmm.
If there's one entity that owns all the broadcast stations in a market, that's one voice, and that's not good for democracy.
Right.
And so I think that still has merit. So that's something we've talked about trying to ensure that's kind of tightened back up. Put back in place to where it was. We would like to see in the last stellar, you know, we had some reform efforts on the joint service agreements and the shared service agreements that the broadcasters were using to stuff that we didn't care about, like buy a news helicopter and
right,
that sort of
right.
things, and that's fine. We have no problem with that. But when they use those same legal entities for two separately owned
for
stations
collusion. Right.
to collude and negotiate, we had a problem with that. The Congress acted and pushed back on that and said that was not allowed. Surprisingly, they have found loopholes in that. We'd like to see that tightened back up. And we've talked a lot about kind of the bundling issue again.
Mm-hmm.
You know, sometimes bundling may be a good thing. You know, sometimes I like walking into McDonald's and
sure.
and I get the value meal, right? And it saves 47 cents when I buy them all together. Sometimes I just want the Big Mac and I'll grab a bottle of water here.
Mm-hmm.
And it depends on my circumstances. And we're not suggesting that Congress needs to step in and mandate one or the other, but just ensuring that maybe, you know, that there should be, you can make the bundle offer, but you also should offer a price for a standalone product if that's what I desire. We've talked about the phantom subscriber issue,
yeah,
which
right.
is a little more little more difficult to walk through, but it's essentially when MVPDs are having to pay to provide a signal for consumers when you're not actually providing that signal because they're getting it with rabbit ears that's plugged into your set-top box. Those are the kind of the top level things, but the consolidation thing is the one that has really been our priority. Cause that's the one, you know, we've got a cancer in the system, and the worst symptom we've got is the consolidation that's happening there, because that has a direct immediate effect. I mean, there's a market in Mississippi, ironically, where a broadcast group has acquired all four stations there.
Right.
Shortly after they acquired them all, they had a retrans deal come through with one of our members. Jacked the prices up immediately, and you know they've been dark for several months. I mean,
right.
It's just not a. I mean, it's common sense.
Sure,
you know, it's just not that hard to understand.
Sure. So Trent and John, let me ask you this as we wind down here. I think it's incredible, and we so do appreciate Congressman Scalise and Congressman Eshoo for their bill and their forthrightness to come out in a bipartisan way to really put a serious piece of legislation on the floor for consideration. But it's still hard work, and there's still a lot of pushback by the broadcasters and networks that say, just say no, don't do anything, okay? I asked you the question before, Trent, why should consumers care, and I'm gonna really ask you guys both, why should members of the Commerce Committees and also members of the House and Senate care about this bill being reauthorized?
Well, because it's the best, it's the right thing to do for the country and for their constituents. As we talked about, the retrans consent regime is a $12 billion hit on our economy. That's a massive hit on the economy. At a time when our economy is wobbling, by the way, but why do we need long-term effects of this where the funds don't go for roads, they don't go for education, they don't go for anything good, the public good, as John was mentioning, they go straight to profits for the broadcasters and others. That's just wrong-headed. And I think the other reason is to align public policy with today's world. It's asinine that we're still living in a 1992 government regime when it's 2019 and all the things we've talked about that have happened, thankfully, for the good, are still going to be polluted and plagued by this wrong-headed way to do things.
Just a point, too, that came out of the earlier hearing you were talking about, Mike, back in June. It was noteworthy earlier this year when a major broadcaster, Nexstar, a public company, posted that more than 50% of its revenue came from retransmission consent, the first time that had ever been recorded, because broadcasters had always said, well, our revenue comes from advertising.
Right.
So this is a trend where retransmission consent is becoming much more important by way of the revenue for the broadcast.
And it's going to get worse if the Nielsen ratings continue to go down for their programming. Talked about like some of the content that's created out there, Game of Thrones, some of these very popular shows are not coming from the broadcasters. And so you have this weird dynamic where Americans are paying much, much, much more for programming that they watch a lot less of.
Yeah.
Which is just wrongheaded and silly.
And they use rules that basically are that haven't changed literally for almost 30 years, where the broadcast model is based on advertising and retransmission consent, and it hasn't changed. I mean, what industry in all of the things that we work on here in Washington hasn't changed in 30 years?
Sure, that's right.
John?
If I'm a congressman or a senator and I'm looking at this and I say, one of the biggest complaints about Congress is, Congress doesn't do anything. If I don't act in the next 4 months, 860,000 people are going to lose television content because Congress did nothing. That should scare me as a member of Congress. In the medium term, I should be very concerned with the fact that my constituents are going to lose out on diverse and independent programming. They're going to lose out on diverse viewpoints because retransmission consent is going to continue to suck up all of the available resources. They're going to lose broadband upgrades because retransmission consent is sucking up all of the available resources. And in the long term, they're going to be paying more for less. And that should be very concerning to me as a member of Congress, particularly when Congress created this regime to begin with. And they can do away with it very simply, and everyone in the marketplace can negotiate without the retransmission consent rules, and broadcasters will still get paid.
That's right.
We don't need these rules to exist. It's just the government thumb on the scale in the marketplace. And if a small company like Rye TV can figure out how to clear its copyrights and sell its content, then certainly
ABC, NBC, CBS, and Fox can figure out how to do the same.
Well said. Well said. John Simpson with Ride TV, Trent Duffy with ATVA, Mike Chappell with ATVA. Fellas, it is a privilege to work with you here in Washington to be advocates together on these important issues for our members, but also for our customers. So thanks for spending some time with us on our DC2U podcast.
Absolutely.
That's it. We're here from DC, DC2U. We'll see you again soon.
What a terrific DC2U podcast with our guests, Mike Chappell of ATVA, their executive director, Trent Duffy, spokesman for ATVA, and John Simpson with Ride TV. These issues are so important for our members. That's why we're so glad to have the folks from ATVA working hand in hand with the ACA Connects on retransmission consent reform for our members, for your customers, and for your communities. Thanks for taking some time to listen or to watch on our DC2U videocast and podcast. Don't forget to subscribe, rate, and review to our ACA Connects podcast. You can find us now at a number of new places, whether Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Stitcher, Google Podcasts, or wherever you get your podcast. And don't forget, you can also find us on our ACA homepage, acaconnects.org/the hub. Seriously, subscribe, rate, and review. We'd love to hear from you. Thanks to Matt Mare, our manager of digital communications, for making this happen. And we will see you again on another ACA Connects DC2U podcast.